Yeah, so he's around here for a little bit more if you guys want to grab him in the break. Thank you very much. Next is Lieutenant Colonel Menachem Landau. He's the head of the UAV branch at the Israel Minister of Defense, the Aeronautic Division. He's responsible, his responsibilities including R&D activities for all related domains, operational and technological concepts, platforms, payloads, communications, propulsion, operator stations, and more. In addition, he is the Israel Ministry of Defense Program Manager for development of unmanned aerial vehicles and drone systems for the IDF. Previous assignments including positions, responsibility for R&D, deployment, development and fielding of UGS systems, electro-optical weapon systems at the IMOD, tactical UAVs for battalion and brigades, shells at the IM, at the Israel Ministry of Defense, IMOD, and IDF GFC Operational Requirements Department. And the program officer at the Technological Division. He's an engineer, which is very important, as a BSc in Mechanical Electro-Optical Engineering from Technion. Thank you very much. You're going next.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Because of the beer and the pizza, I decided to come not on the uniform. to be part of the crowd. Okay, so basically what I wanted to talk today is about unmanned traffic management, which is a big deal worldwide, now that the drones started to develop and they're all over the place. Then I decided to elaborate more dealing with the security issues and still talking about things that makes us special when trying to use drones for military purposes, and I will show you some projects that we are working on with startups and with the traditional industry that work with the Ministry of Defense, and of course everything is unclassified. Okay, so let's look what is going on in the world. Basically the drone market is being larger and larger, not dealing only with drones for hobby, like taking pictures or stuff like that. We see that the market is growing and there are many missions that we want the drones to do, like moving things around. The Amazon project that you've heard about, that currently transferring pizza in Australia or stuff like that. But more and more missions or things to do in urban area, where the crowd, where the building is very crowded, and like Vadim said, you have no GPS and other stuff that is very related to what we see in the battlefield, and I will elaborate later on. And one thing is very important, that all of these drones are flying very, very low altitude, and most of the drones will be flying like 500 meters above the ground and lower. So when we are looking about what is going on in the civilian world, we understand that instead of investing money and developing things that everything is working on for use, for civilian use, we need to, we call it spin-in, to take it inside our systems. And all the buzzwords that we've learned in the last years, like machine learning and video analytics, and autonomy and the energy, like fuel cells and hybrid UAVs and drones and all these worlds, of course we want to take advantage of what is going on outside and bring it inside to the military world and to use it for our use. But still, nevertheless, you need to invest a lot of effort in fields that doesn't interest nobody in the civilian world, like special communication, a requirement for communication in military standards, like navigating without any GNSS navigating inside an urban area, inside buildings, in tunnels, and all the area that you cannot use GPS. And of course, we are talking about not only operating one drone, we want to operate a system that have drone inside to do different parts of the mission. So we need some intelligence or some teaming with these robots. Also, I've written down special payload, but we are talking about lethality and other missions that normally is being used in the battlefield. So we want to see how to do it and how to best use it using this kind of platforms. And of course, all the deconfliction between the drones itself. Let's say you have a company that have a drone, it wants to see what is going on the next building, and you have another company that uses also a drone, you need to make sure that they don't interfere one another. And also if you have helicopters coming in to rescue some wounds or maybe bring supply or whatever, you need to make sure that you don't endanger the pilots. So we've got special issues in our world. Oops. Okay, so I think, yes. So the first example that I can share with you is, we call it the Green Stallion in English, the Vritias one. We used it, it's being produced by Aeronautics. Currently it's under an R&D effort. We've started working with IDF, giving them the opportunity to use it in drills when you need the tactical supply, bringing the supply chain to the soldier that is detached from the main force, and he needs, I don't know, blood, or he needs some equipment that he cannot carry with him. I feel that everyone here that been in the army knows the drill, like you're waiting for the supply and some you send the guy to bring you the supply and he gets lost on the way, he doesn't know where you are, or the stick light stuff at night. So we wanted to cut the supply chain and bring in whatever you need. At the end of the day, the soldier will use his command and control port, will ask for, I don't know what, water, and somewhere the drone will give him the water. So basically we are taking a civilian idea but adjusting it to the military world, and we are talking about minimum 40 kilograms payload of drone. So this is something we need to invest, because currently the civilian world doesn't invest in heavy lifter drones like that. There are some ideas, Uber and other companies, also Google, trying to do mass transportation in urban area, but still we don't see any breakthrough in that area. Another use we use of drones is deploying tear gas along the borders, especially around Gaza Strip, occasionally on Fridays. Noon, if you want to come, you can see demonstrations and people approaching the fence. So we use drones because we want to stop them or to make them leave the area before they reach the border. And we use drones in order to throw down the tear gas. So it's another use we are doing now currently around the borders. Oops. Okay, so basically everybody knows about racers. You can fly up to 200 kilometers per hour, 5 minutes, something that costs several thousand shekels, I don't know, 2,000, 3,000 shekels. You can order it for AliExpress, build it at home, put the goggles and you start walking. And but the problem is, and I can share with you that it's very hard to operate, till DJI started to sell their own version. But till DJI started to do it, it was very difficult to operate. So there is a startup, it's based in the Tel Aviv startup hub. It's called Extend. And basically what they did, they took the goggles and they call it extended reality. You feel like you are the drone, you're walking in the area and you don't have no sticks. you know, you only do gestures with your hands, and you control the drone, and you see what the drone sees. So now we are trying to understand what we can do with this idea, maybe to tackle and engage other drones that you want in the battlefield, to go down the enemy drones, maybe to, like the short clip that was shown here, maybe you want to look with or in front of the soldier when he enters a building. And then all the things that Vadim talked about, mapping the area, walking with no GPS, not getting problems from, you know, the walls or stuff inside, and still moving before the force or with the force. We believe that there is, will be a soldier that will carry drones on his back when you want to enter a neighborhood or an area, urban area that you don't want to risk. Yourself, you can send the drone before you. Maybe the enemy will shot at the drone or stuff like that. And of course, all the data and the intelligence that the drone can give you. And we understand that the synergy between manned soldiers in the field and unmanned systems together can bring us something more relevant that will help the force at the area to do its mission. Let's go back to the civilian world. So I call this slide Paris Air Show. All the data is from Bloomberg or other published data. What is going to be in Paris? Who is considering to visit Paris in 2035? This is what you will see. There is a significant increase in drones and drones missions. Basically, you can see here that the river drones will be all over the place. So you're in the hotel and you want, I don't know, address from Zara, you use the application, you get it from the window, whatever. And the second thing that we are going to see is a UAM, which means air vehicle for mass transportation. So you will not have only the metro, you have also someone that will take you from the window to see sightseeing in Paris. And of course, the commercial flights, more and more tourists will want to come to see Paris. And the hobby drones, they will still be there. And inspection drone, looking at the electricity, all the things that you want to inspect, maybe instead of police officers, whatever. So basically, the future tells us that we are going to see more and more of them. And the conflict and the things that we need to make sure that we'll be. So the system will be safe. We need to think about it today. And when you're close enough, you might have conflicts. And if you're looking at what is happening now, I've put some figures here that shows you how many cases of conflict between manned aircraft and unmanned aircraft are going on. I think that everybody knows about Heathrow incidents, clothing all, and what it does to the economy, and how many flights are postponed or canceled, whatever. So it's going to be more and more, and the problem is already here. So let's talk about the military perspective of this problem. As I mentioned, this thing is called the unmanned traffic, air traffic management, which means that not like today, like, you know, someone is sitting in the tower, looking on the screen, seeing on the flights or the application, whatever. And then he needs to coordinate. Now, this is your time to fly. You need to be in this height, fly in that direction, and control the sky. It happens all over the world all the time. Of course, when we speak, it happens also. But in the drone world, you don't have this capability. Furthermore, when you have thousands of drones up in the air, you cannot control it. So we understand. I think the world is also looking for a solution that will make this problem dealt by robots. So robots is flying, and there will be another robot and special algorithm that will have some hardware inside the other drones or in the commercial planes that will make sure that you are safe and you can move and you can do your mission or do what you wanted to do without being endangered. If we're talking about battlefield, so there's a good news that we don't need to deal with commercial flights, we control the sky. But on the other end, we have Golani, and I don't know if you know Golani. If they are there, they do what they need to do, and they first do it, and then they ask what and why and what happened. So we need to, first of all, give them the capability to do the mission, but second, and also very important, help them and help the sky to be safe. So if now is an Israeli pilot wants to land in order to help Golani, he needs to make sure that he can land safely and nobody is going to hit him with a drone. So this is the main challenge that we are facing regarding controlling the sky. We don't have the right personnel, of course, in the ground forces that will control the sky. Not every drone will be situated in a map, and not all the time the soldiers will listen when you tell them, okay, now go left or right or whatever. So we want the system to do it, okay? And this is a slide I took from Airbus. They've got a dedicated page about UTM and UTM problems. So I think the basic requirements for a military system and for commercial system, basically the same. We're talking about a scalable system that will enable you to work with a lot of drones and also with a few drones. It needs to be safe and give you the understanding that the area is safe and you can walk and you can do whatever you need to be, because you need to be secure. We are talking about cyber problems. You don't want to have problems with the system and someone will tell you that you have a lot of drones in the sky and practically you don't have nothing. The only problem with the military world, that the enemy doesn't cooperate with the system, so we won't see the drones unless we have some radars or some other sensors detecting the red drone, as we call it, and showing it in the system. It needs to be future-proof, because when we are talking about drones, the technology is developing rapidly and the changes are overwhelming. Almost like in our smartphones, every half a year you have another version of another something. And if you bought already the latest version of DJI, once you untucked it and you go home, you need to update the software version. So everything is almost all the time evolving and you need to be up to date. So it should be future proof, like in open architecture, that you are able to integrate new systems. And of course, interoperability, like in everything, is more important. One system that we are working in with a startup that called the Siconia, that is it's an idea of two ex pilots, attack helicopters pilots, that the idea is basically saying that you will have hardware and on the drones and on the helicopter, and like in you have a crowd of drones, and once the attack helicopter approaches and there's opportunity or possibility of a conflict, there will be a set of rules that will tell the drone what to do. So still, like if Golan is in the middle of a mission and they need to helicopter needs to approach the area, the drone will move aside. The mission will still be done in some limitations, but still the helicopter can approach and land or do whatever it needs to do. And if the conflict is being in the upper level and there are problems, there will be an emergency procedures that will tell the pilot, take up, take left. So no need to talk with nobody at home. Everything will be on board and the conflict will be dealt in the battlefield. So I give you some examples how we are currently using and drones and drone technology and what we see as the big challenge in the years to come. And I want to take opportunity to thank for inviting me to speak here today. And I throw it to you. If you have some ideas, you can contact me. The details in the website. And if you have some ideas, if you are a startup owners or you just have an idea, you're more than welcome to contact us and suggest something. Okay? Thank you.
Any question? We have time for one. Okay, great. Thank you very much.